Shortly after this appointment, Hamilton was elected to Congress as a representative of the state of New York, where he served from October 1782 through August 1783. In 1786, the extremely high taxes in Massachusetts led to Shays' Rebellion, which, along with high taxes in the rest of the 13 colonies, it led to the call of reform of the government. Hamilton was one of five delegates of New York chosen to attend the conference in Annapolis. However, many delegates didn't take this meeting seriously and chose not to attend. Without a majority from the states, the articles could not be amended. Hamilton led the request to state governments to attend another convention that would take place in Philadelphia in 1787. Here, the goal would be for the convention to revise the articles completely and not only just certain parts of it. In that same year, Hamilton was elected to serve in the New York State Assembly. Here he fought for Loyalists' protection, as he felt that condemning them would be hypocritical of the new nation. He also continued to fight to have the Articles of Confederation amended. Hamilton's delegation was composed of himself plus two others whose names were Robert Yates and John Lansing. Because these other two feared a centralized government, Hamilton's influence was not successful yet again when the assembly finally met in Philadelphia. Hamilton left the convention after a month's time when he realized he could no longer further his stance while his other two delegates were there with him. Yates and Lansing eventually left the convention themselves in disgust when they came to feel that too many changes were being made to the articles. With their departure, Hamilton went back to Philadelphia to try and place his influence on the other states' delegates, regardless of the fact that he was ineligible to vote, as convention rules clearly stated that a state's vote may not be cast by only one man. The conference eventually divided into two camps of thought. One was called New Jersey and the other Virginian. Hamilton did not like either, but he chose to heavily debate against the Virginian. It was Hamilton's belief that the ideal government did not include state power, but a total centralized government. This was in stark contrast to what other delegates believed who followed Lockean ideas. Hamilton decided to draw up a plan based on English government, but he also took into account the state's desire to retain some of their power. What he ended up with was a government that was divided into three branches: the executive, legislative, Congress, and judiciary, to provide a system of checks and balances for the government. To head the executive branch would be an elected president, which would serve for life, or at least while he was under good conduct. Hamilton and the other states' delegates eventually agreed to a compromise into what is our now existing government today. Once the committee that drafted the Constitution presented the finished draft to the Assembly on September 17, 1787, Hamilton urged all the delegates to sign the document because, although he had reservations about it, he felt that the survival of the new country depended on it. The next step was to get the Constitution ratified. In order for this to happen, 9 of the 13 states needed to approve the document. Hamilton then went back to New York to work on a series of pamphlets and enlisted the help of John Jay and James Madison to assist him in writing these essays that have come to be called the Federalist Papers. Out of the 85 essays, it is believed that Hamilton had written at least 51. They were designed to inform the people of New York State about the new Constitution in an effort to prove to them and also to ease their fears that this reformed government will not take away but protect the liberties they had recently won through the war with England. The campaign worked, and the people of New York chose to ratify the Constitution. Following ratification of the Constitution, Hamilton then went to work campaigning for George Washington to become the first president of the United States of America. In turn, President George Washington appointed Hamilton as the first Secretary of the Treasury, where he was able to implement the financial devices he had once proposed to Robert Morris. He also proposed to Congress that the government should assume all of the state's debt in order to work on paying it off. James Madison was one of the many who opposed the assumption of debt, but Congress came to a compromise when Hamilton suggested that the capital should be moved to a more central location within the colonies so that the southern states will have an ease of mind against tyranny. He suggested the area known as the District of Columbia. Hamilton also had influenced the government's take on foreign policy in that he urged to not get mixed up with European affairs and retain neutrality. After serving 5 years as Secretary of Treasury, he retired back to his law practice up until 1800, when he became involved in campaign efforts for Thomas Jefferson's run for the presidency over his opponent, Aaron Burr. Hamilton's influence in the election angered Burr so much that Burr challenged Hamilton to a duel, in which Burr shot Hamilton in the abdomen, which resulted in his death the following day at 2 o'clock in the afternoon of July 12, 1804. The legacy left by Alexander Hamilton to the United States of America is enormous, more than I can ever cover in a 10-minute speech. There is still more to learn about this early American as historians continue to study his volumes of writings he has left behind that have sat untouched until only the last 100 years. A man who, according to some historians, has been, to some degree, largely overlooked in our history books is well deserving to be placed upon our currency as one of the founding fathers of our nation. Thank you for watching my video.
Who's to say what's impossible? They forgot this world keeps spinning and with each new day I can feel a change in everything, and as the surface breaks, reflections fade, but in some ways they remain the same, and as my mind begins to spread its wings, there's no stopping curiosity. I wanna turn the whole thing upside down. I'll find the things they say just can't be found. I'll share this love I find with everyone. We'll sing and dance to Mother Nature's songs. I don't want this feeling to go away.